With the COVID pandemic dominating the headlines, every fever can be wrongly attributed to an incidental COVID positive test. Dr. Sijoy Kyriakos is from Fellowship Mission Hospital, Odanchatram. He was the gold medalist in DNB General Medicine 2004 batch. He has completed his postdoctoral fellowship in endocrinology. He is a brilliant clinician and amazing teacher. His personal humility and simplicity has been an inspiration to many of us. We are privileged that he has taken time to speak on acute febrile illness in the community.
Good evening. I want to thank the organizers of the Medicine Annual Conference for giving me this opportunity to share with you some insights on acute febrile illness in the community, particularly in the changing context of COVID-19. I have a few disclaimers to make that I'm looking at this from a strictly community angle or a secondary or primary hospital angle rather than a tertiary or teaching hospital angle, which means that there will be a certain number of oversimplifications. The number of differentials that are considered in some of these algorithms might not cover all the possible differentials just because of the rarity of those. And there is also a non-malaria endemic region emphasis that you might find, because that is what we have been seeing in our locality. So that with that caution, I would like to give you an outline of what I'm going to look at in the next few minutes. The definition of AFIs and their classification, how the etiologies are different in the geographical distributions, how to diagnose them, and how to differentiate between these conditions, and an approach to their management from a community perspective. How do we define an AFI? Any fever of less than 14 days duration technically is an acute febrile illness. And if you find a specific cause for that, for example, a UTI, a cellulitis, an otitis media, a tonsillitis, then the approach is specific, treatment is specific, and it's all simple. If you are not able to find out a clear-cut cause in the initial evaluation, then fever can be one of the most complex of medical problems. For all of us who have managed FUOs or pyrexia of unknown origin, we would have found it very difficult. Even the FUOs start as AFIs. It's only a matter of when you pick up these acute febrile illnesses. Now, throwing the COVID-19 scenario also into this has added to the complexity of the whole approach to acute febrile illness. It was William Osler who, one century back, he passed away in 1919, exactly 1 year before the COVID-19 hit the world. He said, "Humanity has but three great enemies: fever, famine, and war. Of these, by far the greatest and by far the most terrible is fever." And we are realizing that he was right in his quote about a century later, when famine and war have been pushed down from the headlines by COVID-19. And this has been overruling our lives for the past many months. So how do you define an acute undifferentiated febrile illness? It is a febrile illness of acute origin with no system or organ-specific etiology. There have been thoughts that it should be 21 days rather than 14 days, because by definition, a pyrexia of unknown origin is more than 21 days. The cause of acute febrile illness and undifferentiated febrile illness, and therefore the approach also varies geographically depending on what etiology is more common in a particular locality. We should also remember that at least at the community level, even up to a secondary hospital level, you would find that a significant number of these patients would not have a cause detected because of lack of facilities or lack of expertise. That is what we find in most of the published literature as well. How are the different undifferentiated fevers classified? One journal in 2014 had brought out this more than 21 days would be FUO, less than 21 days would be AUF, and then further it subdividing into diagnosed and undiagnosed undifferentiated fevers. British Medical Journal brought out another approach of classifying acute febrile illness in 2018. It was looking at localized infection and undifferentiated febrile illness. This is particularly from a malaria endemic region point of view, where acute undifferentiated febrile illness is further divided into malarial and non-malarial because of the sheer commonness of malaria, the ease of its diagnosis, and the potential fatal complications that it could have. In the non-malarial group, can be further divided into viral, bacterial, and parasitic, as we know very well. And how are these etiologies distributed? The study from CMC Velo in 2016, having an impressive number of 1,258 patients, interestingly had 82% of them with a microbiological cause identified. This must be remembered that this is an exception rather than the rule. Being a tertiary center, CMC could have a clinical and as well as a microbiological diagnosis in up to 82% of them. The statistics was like this. The scrub was the most common cause. Again, a regional bias is there, followed by dengue fever, malaria, enteric fever, and leptospirosis. It's interesting how the authors have concluded saying that the similarity in the clinical presentation and the diversity of etiological agents demonstrate the complexity of diagnosis and treatment of AFI in South India. It's not only in South India, anywhere in the world. It's a similarity of this clinical presentation, but their diversity in etiology that makes it more complex. Now, adding COVID to this further complicates the whole scenario. This is another article which looked at it from BMC Infectious Diseases about the etiologies of undifferentiated febrile illnesses in South and Southeast Asia. It's a systematic review of 43 studies. In fact, the previous study that I mentioned was one of these 43 studies, an impressive number of 80,000 patients, both IP and OP, and etiology was identified only in about one third of them, 37%. This is very close to the real world situation. Maybe even lesser than that would be there, where etiology is microbiologically identified. Their finding was viral infections are the commonest as expected, followed by bacterial and protozoal infections, predominantly malarial. Among the viral infections, it was dengue fever that was the commonest. Again, another study from multiple centers, CMC being the coordinating center, and many of our peripheral hospitals, including the place where I work, Christian Fellowship Hospital, Ottanjathiram, was also part of the study. Between 2011 and 12, 1,564 patients, both in the pediatric and adult age group from six different states of India. We found about 17% had malaria, 16 dengue, and followed by scrub, bacteremia, leptospirosis, and chikungunya. There was a high rate of overlap between diagnoses. This could be because of the serological tests that were used, and also probably because there were a lot of undiagnosed previous infections in the community, which could have led to this finding. This BMJ article in 2018 had suggested this mnemonic of MAESR, including malaria, arboviral infections, enteric fevers, parochial infections, and rickettsial infections. Somewhere in this MAESR, you will have to now add a C for COVID-19 as well. So that makes it six main disease groups instead of five. COVID-19 would come into this. So how do we diagnose them and differentiate them? Of course, this is very well known to us for all the localized infections. You look for specific signs or symptoms pertaining to that system. If it is available, specifically investigate and you have a diagnosis, well and good. But if it is not there, then that is where we have to look at the commonness of certain things. Are there certain features which would favor a particular diagnosis or the other? From the previous study that I mentioned, they found that the features that were more favoring scrub typhus was a female gender, the presence of dyspnea, WBC count of more than 10,000, and an albumin of less than 3.5 grams. Whereas overt bleeding manifestations, a lower WBC count and lower platelet count suggested dengue fever, and longer duration of fever and presence of loose stools suggested enteric fever. This is a crowded slide, sorry for that, but this is a fever, what is called as a fever identification chart from the British Medical Journal. They have looked at what is the commonest differentiating features clinically as well as from common investigations. If you can look at only those solid triangles, rash being very common in dengue and very unlikely in malaria. Eshkar, as we very well know, is common in scrub typhus, almost 50% of them having that. Jaundice in malaria and leptospirosis, conjunctival suffusion in leptospirosis, lymphadenopathy generally suggesting a diagnosis other than malaria and probably other than enteric fever as well. Muscle tenderness is more common with leptospirosis. Of course, splenomegaly can be part of anything. Can COVID present with any of these? Commonly not, but in severe disease, COVID can have any of these symptoms, including jaundice and muscle tenderness, but not so common in the garden variety of COVID that we see. How about the other symptoms like dyspnea? Very well goes with scrub typhus and of late COVID-19. Acute renal failure more common in leptospirosis and malaria, and shock in leptospirosis and bleeding manifestations, we very well know, goes in favor of dengue fever. How about the total count? The WBC count being low in dengue fever and the initial stages of enteric fever at least, high in scrub typhus and leptospirosis. Thrombocytopenia can be there in any of these, but more common in dengue fever, leptospirosis, scrub typhus and malaria than in enteric fever and COVID-19. What are the features in comparison to these five common diagnoses and comparing that with COVID? Dyspnea, especially dyspnea which starts about 5 to 7 days after the onset of illness, is common with COVID-19. And some of those other complications are seen only in severe COVID-19 disease. How about the leukocytosis? Initially, COVID usually presents with leukopenia, like most of the other viral illnesses, followed by neutrophilia, including a leukocytosis, which could come in the presence of a cytokine storm, which comes towards the end of the second week, towards the end of 10 days or so. Thrombocytopenia is very well documented in COVID-19, but usually it is mild. Looking at some of those rule-in features is what we are seeing right now. Some of those rule-out features, malaria, presence of rash and lymphadenopathy generally goes against malaria and enteric fever. A fever which persists more than 2 weeks is against a diagnosis of dengue fever. I'm just quoting directly from up to date about COVID-19. Are there any features which are ruled out or ruled in case of COVID-19? Although some clinical features, particularly smell and taste disorders, are more common in COVID-19 than with others, none of them are really able to distinguish. However, the development of dyspnea approximately a week after the onset of initial symptoms may be, just may be, suggestive of COVID-19. Interestingly, this Cochrane review has come up just 1 month back where they looked at which are the signs and symptoms which could determine that a patient presenting to the OPD in a primary care or a secondary care or a hospital outpatient setting has COVID-19. They looked at all the published literature and this was their conclusion. They said, based on the currently available data, neither absence nor the presence of any of the signs or symptoms are accurate enough to rule in or rule out COVID-19 disease. So that is where we stand. We are not really better off after 1 year to differentiate or distinguish COVID from others based on our clinical features. So what are the common investigations that we could do? A hemogram and a peripheral smear for malarial parasite and urine microscopy might be available in most of the centers, even a primary health center. If further facilities like a secondary hospital could do a blood culture, a chest x-ray and ultrasound of the abdomen. For specific investigations, malaria, we know the peripheral smear, both the thick smear and the thin smear would help. Blood cultures are very specific for enteric fever and serology for scrub, leptospirosis and dengue fever. Whereas in COVID-19, different states have different policies. In Tamil Nadu, it is RT-PCR. In many of the other states, I understand that it is a rapid antigen test followed by RT-PCR in the algorithm. So, is there a sequence by which if you do not have COVID-19 and then the other acute undifferentiated febrile illnesses, is there a specific sequence in which you should test? This is a study from IDSA, looking at India and Cambodia, and they found that simultaneous testing is not really advisable in the community setting. Sequential testing is better, and the algorithm differs geographically. They found that it is different for Cambodia and different in India. They found that the order probably, in at least in some places of India, it would be dengue followed by scrub, malaria, leptospirosis, and typhoid in that order. So how do we approach? This is a secondary hospital approach to an acute febrile illness. We essentially ask three questions. First question is, the patient sick? The patient is sick, we admit, and then manage as per the sepsis guidelines, whether you use QSOFA or SIRS, which many of us still prefer over QSOFA because of its ease of use and its objectivity. Is there a localizing feature? That is the second question that we ask. If there is a localizing feature, you test for the same, confirm, manage accordingly. If there is, it is not there, then is there a possibility of COVID-19? Investigate and manage appropriately. If none of these are there, then the question of other questions of sequential testing of acute undifferentiated febrile illness comes in, and even the question of empiric therapy is coming there. Is empiric therapy really there? Yes, it is available, very tempting, but at the same time dangerous because of resistance patterns emerging, because of missing the right diagnosis, and because of the wrong confidence that it might give a physician, telling that you are treating everything that is possible. The common favorites are anti-malarials, antibiotics like azithro, which could cover enteric fever, rickettsial infections, and leptospirosis, anti-rickettsial like doxycycline, and rarely antitubercular therapy. Most of the PUO guidelines would mention antitubercular therapy empirically as one of the parts of their algorithms, but not usually in acute undifferentiated febrile illness. There is a recent article from IDSA, again in Clinical Infectious Diseases, about comparison of ceftriaxone versus azithromycin in the treatment of undifferentiated febrile illness in Nepal. It's interesting, the editorial comment on this, the editor has commented not really whether ceftriaxone is better or azithro is better, but the problem that is really at the forefront is the lack of point of care diagnostics for common tropical infections. That is the most important issue. And it is important to also identify a subset of patients who may benefit from empirical therapy, that is those with rickettsial, and presumably with rickettsial infections or enteric fever. And targeting them with azithromycin could be a good option, but it is never it can never be a thing for standardization for all patients. Okay, so finally, how do we summarize? This is a algorithm that we use. We have found it useful in our setups in secondary hospitals. It may not be very true for all situations, but what we generally look at is like this: is it acute febrile illness? If so, is there a localized infection? If there isn't a localized infection other than ILI, you generally test for it, and if proven, treat accordingly. If it's an ILI or an acute undifferentiated febrile illness, then the next step would be to do an RT-PCR for COVID or whatever other reliable or sensitive test is, that is available. And if it is positive, you treat it as COVID-19. And if it is negative and still you think the clinical suspicion of COVID is quite high, then go for a CT thorax. There are controversies regarding CT thorax, but this is from the WHO recommendations, especially for resource limited situations where RT-PCR availability and its timing, all these things are a challenge. The CT thorax has been suggested by the WHO, but not really recommended by the American Radiology Association. So if it is CORADS 4 or 5, you would still consider COVID-19 in a patient with high clinical suspicion and treat accordingly. If it is negative, that is CORADS 1, 2, or 3, then you test for other acute undifferentiated febrile illnesses in the order of commonness for your locality. If the clinical suspicion of COVID is low, then you look for those pointers, rule-in features, rule-out features, as we already mentioned. If any of them point towards a particular diagnosis, say scrub typhus or leptospirosis, then you specifically focus your testing onto that. And if the diagnosis is there, you treat accordingly. If after all these, if you do not have a clear diagnosis, that is where the question of whether empiric therapy should be given or not comes in. This is how we look at an acute febrile illness from the community perspective. Thank you for your patient listening.